What are some of your favorite moments that you've been a part of as a commentator in WWE?
Oh, man. Kofi Mania. Yes. That was something that hit home for me because Kofi was one of the guys who was there in the beginning when I started with FCW. And, you know, it's him. You had Natalya, Tyson Kidd, Sheamus, so many guys who have just been staples of today's WWE. But Kofi was one of those guys. I remember Dr. Tom had asked him, hey, can you work out with this kid a little bit, teach him some things? And I just remember him being so gracious and so humble and so giving with his knowledge. And the cool thing for me is that, you know, here we are 13 years later and Kofi is still that guy. Like he hasn't changed. I mean, he is just as humble and kind, as warm-hearted as he was the first day I met him, you know? And so to see someone like that, who's been around so long, who's worked so hard, and to finally get his just due, and to see the crowd like right there with him every step of the way. There are two times that I've cried in wrestling. The first time was when Ultimate Warrior beat Hulk Hogan at WrestleMania 6. I was absolutely heartbroken. The second time was when Kofi won the WWE Championship because he broke down a barrier. He no one looked at him and said, that guy's going to be world champion. And he defied those odds. He showed people, if you put in the work, if you don't stop pushing, you can reach the top. And to see that story happen and to see how everybody was so emotionally moved by that just brought tears to my eyes. So that will forever be like, just, I'm getting goosebumps now just thinking about it.
I am too, because I remember your call when that happened. I remember sitting at the desk and you just went off, like you just opened your mouth and the stuff that came out was so appropriate, almost poetic and real, because that was coming from your heart.
No matter who you are, no matter where you come from, no matter what you look like, if you believe, you can make it happen.
In my opinion, as long as I've worked with you at least, that was the best call of your career. And what a fitting moment, the WWE Championship at WrestleMania, because it was just, you could tell you were feeling that, man. And that sticks, like you telling the story gave me goosebumps again, which that just speaks, you know, to how impactful it was. So congratulations on that, you know, 2 years late, but...
No, thank you.
So what else? What else are some of your favorite moments?
I'm going to go back to, I want to say it was 2015, the night after WrestleMania in Santa Clara, California. This was Raw in San Jose. And it was a night that Brock Lesnar had basically taken out the entire announce team.
Oh, yes. I remember this. This is the first time in my career that my name, Corey Graves, ever trended.
So I won't say this isn't one of my favorite moments, but it's memorable.
Yes.
Get ready to go out and I find out you're going out there by yourself, bro. That's a serious butt puckering moment for me. I'm like, what? So I'm going out there and like, I start, you know, running down to the ring. And of course we have like the fans from all over the world, the WWE universe, like, you know, they're all pumped up and rowdy. So they see me come down the aisle and all of a sudden I hear a Byron Saxton. And now I'm like, okay, I'm feeling myself. Yeah, I can do this. I'm over, man. They love me. Well, that's where it stopped.
Yeah. So that's where, to hear you.
No, they had, that's the point. So I remember we were in a commercial break and the crews were trying to flip the table back over so I could sit down and I couldn't get it in time. And that was just a precursor of things to come. The producer's like, all right, we got to come back. Just leave the table as it is. So I come back, welcome everybody to Raw. You know, obviously the announce team's destroyed. It's just me. And I remember specifically at one point calling a match out there. And because the table was still kind of lodged over on the side, the monitor was stuck in the table. And so I had to sit on the floor and look up at the monitor and call the match. And at that point, it hit me. Why in the world am I out here in the fetal position on the biggest Raw of the year calling this show by myself? What is wrong with the world? And that was only the beginning. I mean, obviously, like you said, your name was trending. I typically don't, you know, I'll check Twitter and all that stuff. And I'm like, kind of whatever. I take it with a grain of salt. I don't stress it. Sometimes I don't look at it at all. And I just, Byron sucks. We hate Byron. It got so bad to the point that I went home and my mom walks in the room, who can't even, she can barely turn on her iPhone. she says to me, "Oh, I heard you got in trouble at work for what you did at Raw." I'm like, "How did you hear about this?" What is going on here? So it was like, I'm not going to lie, it was tough because, again, we don't, it wasn't the best performance of my life. I can admit that. I was nervous. I wasn't sure what I was doing. I wasn't ready for that.
In your defense, you also weren't doing your job. You weren't playing your role. Yeah. and Michael Cole's got some pretty damn big shoes to fill.
Yeah. So I just remember, like, you feel like the smallest person in the world because you're just getting all this hate. And I wouldn't change that moment for the world because I can still say that I went out there and called Monday Night Raw by myself in the fetal position. And I'm not sure anybody else can say that, right?
That's it. That's a title solely possessed by Saxton.
Yeah.
But I do want to hear real quick about 316 Day.
Yes. 316 Day, Stone Cold Steve Austin, a special guest. And then next thing you know, I find out I'm actually going to be involved in a segment with Stone Cold Steve Austin. Yet another butt-puckering moment for me in my career. So the fan of me is like, "Ooh, I'm ready for this." And the other side of you is like, "Oh my gosh, I don't want to screw this up." And you know, so we're like, we're guzzling the beer. It's like dripping all over the place. All of a sudden, boom, there's a stunner. Bam, you know. And then, of course, if you watch back the video, you'll see that the initial kick was a little low into the discos. And I remember I got the kick, got the stunner, and I'm laying there. Stone Cold comes by, "Sorry, kid." You know, he proceeds to drink some more. But that, see, everyone's like, "Oh my gosh, Saxton got hit there," which hurt. But that wasn't the worst part. The worst part was when Raw went off the air, and like I think I had a total of like 3 or 4 stunners between Stone Cold and Becky Lynch, and a couple happened off air. And at one point, you know, Stone Cold's catching more beer cans. Well, I'm laying in the center of the ring. He misses the beer can and boom, gets me right in the face. So I'm like, that was the worst part of it all, because I ended up having a black eye afterwards.
Oh, that's
so
amazing.
I kind of like gingerly kind of turned my body over. I'm like, "Oh my gosh, this is so cool, but it hurts so bad." And then afterwards, of course, my suit is like drenched. It smells like beer. And I call my mom, because my mom always watches the show. So we always talk afterwards. And she's like, "You better not drive home. I mean, if you get pulled over and your suit smells like alcohol, they're not going to let you go."
Mama Sags got your back all the time, man.
So to this day, I still have that suit. And there's still, like, I'll never wear it again because it's all stained up. But I tell you what, man, that is definitely such an honor. It was such an honor just to be in that position and to share the ring with Stone Cold. And the 15-year-old me was like, "No way this is happening."
Like what you hear? Catch full episodes of After the Bell on Apple Podcasts. Subscribe now and never miss an episode.